Okay, ma'am. Okay, today this session we will be starting. In the previous session we had completed unit 1, and this session we will start our unit 2. Our unit 2 will be about combinational circuits. So we'll see the agenda for today's session. So we will have a quick recap of complete important topics which we covered in unit 1. Then we'll see the types of digital circuits. Then we'll see what is combination, what is sequential. Then we'll see how to analyze a given combinational circuit, and then how to design a combinational circuit, and the design of some arbitrary combinational circuits, and designing code converters, and finally exercise problems which you can work out before we come to the next session. And most importantly, we will have an online quiz at the end of the session. I'll give you the link in the chat, and all of you are requested to complete the online quiz. So the quiz will have an online quiz which covers the first unit. So it will be, as far as digital is concerned, we have 15 altogether, 20 questions, 15 one mark questions and 5 two mark questions. So totally we'll have for 25 marks. Okay, so you can easily get through it. 5 questions you need to work out and then select the choice. So don't leave in between. So your link for the quiz will be given only at the end of this session in your chat box. Clear? Okay. So that's why I want to give you a quick recap of unit 1. So in unit 1, we have seen, we have discussed number systems. Then we have discussed complementary number systems, that is ones and twos representation and signed magnitude representation. Then we also discussed binary codes. Then we solve few simplification of Boolean functions using Boolean theorems. And then we converted Boolean functions in standard form, that is canonical forms. And then we used K-map for simplification of Boolean functions. And finally, we implemented Boolean functions using NAND and NOR gates. So this is the overall structure of your unit 1. Okay, so a quick recap on what all examples what we have seen. You can just recap whatever we have done. So if you want to convert any number into decimal, any number system to decimal, you have to multiply by their corresponding weights. Okay, so here binary is converted to decimal. So binary, the weight of individual bits will be powers of 2, so multiply by 2 and you will can add. Okay, same way, same procedure you will follow when you want to convert octal or hexadecimal to decimal. So for octal it will be powers of 8, and for hexadecimal it is powers of 16. Okay, so any base, if you want to convert to decimal, you will multiply by the base to the power depending on the position, and then add the weights. Okay, this is the first procedure. Then the next one is to convert into binary. So to convert to binary, you need to do repeated division. So here you have got a decimal number 254, decimal to binary, you have got 254, which is repeatedly divided by 2, and then now the remainder is taken at the end. Here you have the remainder, and then when you are writing the number, you write from the bottom to the top. So your least significant digit will be at the top and your most significant digit will be at the bottom. Similarly, if you want to convert from decimal to octal, you have to do a repeated division by 8, same procedure. And if you want to convert decimal to hexadecimal, then you need to convert, do a repeated division by 16. Okay, so same procedure. Either in the first, when you want to convert to decimal, you will do a multiplication of the weights. If you want to convert a decimal to binary, octal or hexadecimal, you will do repeated division process. Okay. Then binary to octal, you will do a grouping. So binary to octal, you have to group a group of 3 bits. So every 3 bits together, you will do a grouping. And if it is binary to hexadecimal, you will have to do a grouping of 4 bits. So if it is 3 bits, you will take 4 to 1 as the weight. And if it is hexadecimal 4 bits, it is 8, 4, 2, and 1. Okay. So you will group and write. And if you have fractional numbers, you will start. So you might have many numbers. This is the decimal point. And here also, if you have some binary, you will have to start grouping from the decimal digit, decimal point. Okay. So from the decimal point, you have to start grouping. So in case you have, you don't have sufficient number of ones. So if it is octal, you have to group in threes. And if the most significant part does not have a sufficient number of ones, then you can add zeros in the most significant bit. Likewise, in the fraction, if you're grouping and if you cannot have correct grouping, you can add zeros at the end. Okay, so binary to octal is grouping of grouping bits in threes, and binary to hexadecimal will be grouping in fours. Okay. Then the reverse, octal to binary and hexadecimal to binary. You have to do a reverse process. So here, previously we did a grouping and we wrote the number. Now you have to represent the number, expand and write either in 3 bits or in 4 bits. Okay, again, same 4, 3, 1 and 8, 4, 2, 1 and 8, 4, 2, 1. So if you want to convert to binary, you have to expand either in 3 or 4 bits, depending on whether it is octal or hexadecimal. Clear? Okay. Then in case you want to have fractional part. So fractional part, if you want to convert into binary to decimal, again, decimal always, if you want, you will multiply by the powers. So here you can multiply by power. Since it's binary, you have to multiply by powers of 2. So from the decimal point, you have to start. So this is 2 power minus 1, then 2 power minus 2, minus 3, minus 4, likewise. So same way, here the decimal point is somewhere here. So it is octal. The number is octal. So 8 power minus 1, then 8 power minus 2. Likewise, it goes. Clear? So then binary to octal. So binary number to octal here in fractions. Fractions also same procedure. So you need not worry whether the binary number is an integer or a fractional part. The same procedure. The only thing you need to know is you have to start from the decimal point. Okay. So this is about our number system conversions. The next we saw negative number representations. So we have three negative number representations. So one is the signed magnitude, the other one one's complement, and the other one two's complement. So in signed magnitude, you will have a sign bit separately and the magnitude will be represented separately. And in one's complement, you will write the number in binary and then take a complement of individual bits. So here you can see individual bits are complemented. In 2's complement, it is just nothing but 1's complement plus 1. You will get 2's complement. Okay. So when we do addition, you should know binary addition. So binary addition is different from your OR operation, basic OR operation. It is addition operation, so arithmetic operation. So 0 plus 0, it is 0. Then 0 plus 1, 1. 1 plus 0 also, it is 1. When you have 1 plus 1, you will have 1, 0. So the sum part will be 0 and this 1 will be taken as a carry to the next higher digit. Okay. And Similarly, you have subtraction also. We learn subtraction, but usually you won't need a subtraction table. You need not remember this, because we, for subtraction, we will do 1's complement or 2's complement subtraction. And 2's complement subtraction will be better because we don't have a negative zero representation in 2's complement. But you should know the basic binary subtraction table. So this is the rule for 1's complement and 2's complement subtraction. So you will take the represent the negative number either in 1's complement or 2's complement form depending on the problem. And once you have the 1's complement or 2's complement representation, do a binary addition. Perform an ordinary binary addition. Then in case there is no carry, then the result itself is a negative number. So you have to check the most significant bit if there is no carry. So it will be in a negative number. So you have to again take 1's complement or 2's complement and put a negative sign. Suppose there is a carry, then if it is 1's complement, you have to perform an end around addition. That means from the most significant bit, you have to bring it to the least significant bit and perform the addition again. Okay, so if you have a carry. Suppose you are using a 2's complement addition, subtraction, then if you have a carry, you just need to discard it. That is the only difference between 1's and 2's complement. Otherwise, both procedures are same. Then we performed BCD addition. So in BCD, so what is BCD? In BCD, we will represent binary coded decimal. So the difference is, if it is 10, so 10 in decimal form. Okay, this is a decimal number. So this decimal number, if you want to represent in binary, I will represent it as 1010. Clear? So it is 8421, so 8 plus 2, it is 10. Suppose I am representing in BCD. So in BCD, I have to represent the individual digits separately. So 1 will be represented in 4 bits, 001, and the 0 will be represented as a 4-bit number separately. So this becomes 1 and this becomes 0. So this is the representation of 10 in BCD. So what is the difference between this representation and this representation? Here, the binary equivalent in BCD is, the position here is 16. So this is 8, 4, 2, and 1, and this is 16. So this number, binary representation with a weight of 10 is converted into a weight of 16 for representation. The same thing will hold good. So suppose I'm having 11, it will be represented as 17. So here you will have 6, here you have 001, and here in this position you will have a 1. So that means the binary equivalent of that number will be equal to 17. So every number, to make it into a valid BCD, you have to just add 6 to make it into a valid BCD. Okay. So that is the one we learnt in BCD addition. So in binary codes, we saw different binary codes, numeric, alphanumeric, then error detection and error correction codes. And the numeric codes are weighed as well as your non-weighed. So weighed means your binary is an example for a weighed code. Non-weighed, can anyone give an example for non-weighed? You remember any example for non-weighed codes? Just give it in your chat box. Just quick. Few examples which you remember for non-weighed codes. Yes, any non-weighed code? XS3, very good. Then, anything else? One code which we have been using in KMAP. Gray code, very good. Gray code is, yes. So gray code and XS3 codes are examples of non-weighed codes. Okay, and you, very good, Ma. So in further, you can also have negative weights or positive weights, then self-complementing codes or reflective codes. So gray code is an example of a reflective code, okay? And sequential and cyclic code. Sequential is if you add one to the previous number, the next number you can get. Then cyclic codes, you can either rotate in a cyclic form and from one code and get the other. Okay, either you can shift right or shift left and get the code. So then we all started with Boolean theorems. So all Boolean theorems, whatever you are learning in your mathematics, that is discrete maths, and your digital theorems, both are same. Only the representations are different. Okay, there you are using P, Q, and here we are using X, Y, Z, A, B, C, likewise. Okay, so theorems are all same, and few theorems. X plus 0 is x, then x plus x dash equals 1, x plus x is equal to 1, x plus 1 equal to 1. Then here few the theorems on dual of the theorems are also given. Then commutative law, associative, distributive, then De Morgan's, and then absorption. So absorption law, you can learn the law, but you can prove that by using the basic theorems which are listed in the first part of your table. Okay, by applying the basic theorems, you can introduce the missing variables, and then you can expand and you will get the absorption theorem proved. Then we also saw canonical forms, summation of min terms or product of max terms. So there are two ways. So if you need to simplify using Boolean theorems, then directly you can apply the laws which we have, which are given in the table, and simplify. Suppose you need to use a K-map for simplifying, it should be in standard form. Only for those expressions or Boolean expressions, you will be able to do a K-map simplification. So in case you have any missing variable in a Boolean expression, you have to introduce the missing variable, make it into sum of min terms, canonical forms, or product of max terms, and then plot them in the K-map, and then do the simplification. Okay. So this is another important. So if you have a truth table, you can represent the truth table in terms of a Boolean expression. So F is a sum of all min terms whose function is 1. And F complement is a sum of all min terms whose function value is 0. That is the way we represent the function F in terms of min terms. Same truth table can be represented in the form of max terms. So F can be represented as all max terms whose function is 0. And F complement can be represented as all max terms whose function value is 1. So the reverse. So this you should always know, because we will be using it in solving the K-maps. Then few hints we saw in the K-map for simplification. The goal of your K-map is to maximize the size of your group, and finally minimize the number of groups. So number of groups should be less, but the size of individual groups should be more. Okay, but you cannot group them as you wish. You have to group in powers of 2 only. So 2 power 0 is equal to 1. So it can be 1, 2, then is 4, 8, 16, 32, 64. Okay, so it can be a group in powers of 2. So these are few valid groups and few groups which you need to avoid. So this is your wraparound adjacency. Then this is also wraparound. This is a complete column. Here you can have overlapping groups. The condition is at least you should have only at least one unique one for that group. So this is also wraparound, which is allowed. Here, this is not allowed because the number of ones in that group is equal to 6, which is not powers of 2. Here, you cannot have a group like this. Either it should be a triangle or, a rectangle, or it has to be a square. Okay, you cannot have diagonal adjacency. So this can be grouped into two groups separately, not as a 4. And this diagonal adjacency is not allowed. So here, this is also not allowed. If this is the case, you can have a group of 2 like this. And the goal of our KMAP is to maximize the size of a group. So here, it is possible for us to make it into a group of 4, even if it is overlapping. So this is not allowed, and this is a valid one. Clear? So these are few ways. So there are many combinations. So every problem will have a different combination, and you should be able to apply the rules and group properly. Okay. So once you group, then you can write the product term. So write only the common variables in the row and the column, and that will be the product term. And finally, you can sum all the product terms and write SOP. And hope you know how to plot. So the rest of the second step, third step, and fourth step will be right only if you plot it properly. So when you plot, you have to label the KMAP properly. It should be labeled in gray code. So 0, 1, last row will be 2, and then 3. Okay. So remember that labeling. So label the cells, label the rows, label the columns with the binary equivalent as well as the variables, and before you start grouping. Because once you plot and when you group, then it will become congested. So first clearly label them without any error, and then proceed for plotting and grouping so that you won't make a mistake. Because just a single 4 variable KMAP with you will have to draw the KMAP and write the expression, you might be given 15 marks. So you should not go wrong in that. Okay, so we also saw various forms of KMAP. Okay, so either you can write in SOP form or POS form, given SOP or given POS, any type of representation you should be able to plot and then give the group. Then universal gates, NAND and NOR are universal gates because it's easier for them to fabricate in the chip. So NAND and NOR are used for representing the basic gates. So the base behind are so that's why we are using we learned De Morgan's law. So if it is NOT gate, whether it is NAND or NOR representation, it is the same input given to both the inputs of the gates. Okay, this is NAND and this is NOR. And then if it is AND gate, and if you want to use a NAND, just complement it. Complement of AND will become NAND. So you have a NAND gate, and the output of the NAND gate is complemented. The same concept you can use for NOR. Okay, so NOR gate, we can directly implement OR gate. So first you have the NOR gate, NOR gate followed by your NOT, NOT is, that is complement, will become your OR gate. So for NAND, AND representation will be easier, and for NOR, OR representation will be easier. Then the reverse. So the reverse, you have to complement the inputs and then give it to the AND gate. Same concept here for AND. Complement the inputs and give it to the NOR gate. Okay. So this is a quick recap of your unit 1. Hope all of you are clear with unit 1. So at the end I'll give you an link for quiz. So now we will go to the type unit 2, which where we'll start with the types of digital circuits. So logical boolean circuits or digital circuits, or we can call them as switching circuits. So logical circuits, boolean circuits or digital circuits all means the same, because we it's on and off, we call them as switching circuits. So there are two types of switching circuits. One is a combinational and the other one is a sequential. So the basic circuit which we have been seeing so far or discussing so far is a combinational circuits. So combinational circuit is a combination of all your basic gates and your universal gates, or XOR, XNOR, all those gates, you call it as a combinational circuit. The other one is your sequential circuit. The sequential circuit is having a memory element. So if you have a memory attached to the combinational circuit, then you will, or a feedback path, then you will see the diagram. We'll call it as a sequential circuit. So this sequential can be again of two types, asynchronous sequential or synchronous sequential. And this is the structure of your entire 4 units now. So in your unit 2, we will be discussing combinational circuits. Unit 3, we will be discussing sequential, asynchronous sequential circuits. And unit 4, we will be discussing synchronous sequential circuits. And in unit 5, we will be discussing memory separately. Okay. So this is the structure of all your 5 units or 4 units in your digital. Second, third, and fourth. And finally, memory in addition. So the main difference between combinational and sequential is combinational circuits do not have a memory, and whatever input you give, you will immediately get the output. But in sequential circuits, there is a memory element or there will be a feedback path, and your output of the circuit depends on the current input as well as the previous state. Because it has a memory or you have a feedback path, the previous state of the circuit will also have an effect on the output of the circuit. Okay, before we go into details, we'll see what is the application of a combinational, because second unit will deal only with combinational. So in combinational, we have different categories. So the main use of combinational circuit CPU or contains arithmetic logical unit, and this arithmetic logical unit is mainly your combinational circuit. And if you see your memory and the communication between one component to another components, then certain devices which are synchronized by the clock pulse of your CPU, all those comes under your sequential circuits. Clear? So the main part or main application of your combinational circuit is to design your arithmetic logical unit. So that is the main function. So arithmetic logical is your adders, subtractors. Your logical function is your comparators. And in addition, you also have program. PLD is programmable logic devices that we will see later. Okay, so we'll focus on adders, subtractors, and magnitude comparators, whether A is less than B, greater than B, or whether A is equal to B. So all those operations we'll design a circuit. And you also have another type of combinational circuit called multiplexers, demultiplexers, encoders, and decoders, which are mainly used for data transmission from one component of your CPU to another. Okay, suppose I want to transmit one, I have many inputs and I want to have only one output, then I can use a multiplexer. Or I can have a reverse such that I have only one input, I want to distribute it to many other components in my CPU, then I can use a demultiplexer. So multiplexers, demultiplexers are used for data transmissions, and encoders and decoders are used for selecting the component. Suppose we are executing a program. When we are executing a program, you are writing a high level code. So when you write a high level code, when you compile it, it is converted into a machine code. So these machine codes are nothing but they are machine instructions. So a single instruction, high level instruction, in turn will be converted into 5 or 10 machine level instructions. Each of these instruction will have a hardware component. Suppose I'm having an instruction A equal to B plus C in my program. That in turn will be converted into some 5 or 6 machine level instruction. First I load it into a register, then add the contents, then store it in another register. Likewise, I'll divide it into many steps. Each of the instruction will have a hardware component. Okay, so suppose I'm having an instruction add, that means I'll have to use an adder, design an adder circuit. Okay, so suppose I have a sub instruction, that means there should be a subtraction circuit. So every digital circuit will have a corresponding machine level instruction with which we can enable it. So to enable and activate and deactivate some depending on the current instruction, you need certain circuits which we call it as encoders and decoders, just for enabling and disabling different parts of your CPU. Okay, then the third part of combinational circuit is your code converters. So code converters will convert from one code to another, and we'll see few applications. One application will be in your traffic light. Yes, you have a counter in your traffic light. So a circuit will be there which will keep on incrementing or will decrement, and from that decremented value it has to be displayed in a 7-segment LED display. Okay, 30, 29, 28, likewise. So the underlying circuit will do an addition or subtraction, and it will be converted into a 7-segment display. So you have to do some code conversion. So we'll see how to design all. Once you understand the concepts, then there is nothing to learn here. Okay, you need not learn, sit and learn. You can blindly follow the procedure. You just understand the concepts. So here is a block diagram of a combinational circuit. So what will your combinational circuit contain? What will this circuit contain? Yes? What is it made up of? I want few answers in the chat box. This is just a block diagram. What will this combinational circuit contain? It is made up of logical gates. Very good, very good. Logical gates, basic gates. Okay, so it's made up of basic gates. So you can have n number of inputs. So in our truth table, we listed the variables x, y, z as inputs. So you can have n number of inputs to the logical circuit. And as of now, in our unit, we have been unit one, we have been discussing only one output, but in practice can have many outputs. So F, we have been talking about F. So this F is nothing but the output of your combinational circuit. So in between, you can have any complex expression which can be implemented. So what does this output depend on? This output depends only on the input that is given. So whatever input you give, according to the combinational logic, you will get the output. Clear? So here you can have n variables. So if you have in general n variables, how many possible combinations you can have? 2 power n input combinations you can have. So you can represent a combinational logic in the form of a truth table So if you have n variables, you will have n input columns. And how many rows will be there? 2 power n rows will be there. And how many output columns will be there? M output columns will be there in your table. Clear? So altogether, number of columns will be n plus m. And the number of rows in the truth table will be equal to 2 power n, which depends only on the number of input. Clear? So this is the pictorial block diagram representation of a combination sequential circuit. So here you can see your base for your sequential circuit is also a combinational circuit. So here you can see the combinational circuit. It's made up of your AND gate, OR gate, or if you implement using universal gates, it will be NAND and NOR. And you will have inputs and you will have outputs. But in addition to it, you will also have a feedback path. The output, one or more of the outputs of the combinational circuit will be fed back to the same circuit. And either you can, this part is optional, either you can have a memory element or you need not have a memory element. That's why there is a difference. So if you do not have a memory element, and if you have only the feedback path, then you call it as an asynchronous sequential circuit. And if you have a storage or memory element, then you call it as a synchronous sequential circuit. Clear? And always when you have to remember that synchronous means it should be synchronized with the clock. So in our campus, so we are all synchronized to the common bell. At 8:30, we have a bell. And we know whether you are a faculty or a student or whoever is inside the campus, we all know that it is the start of the day. And at 9:20 or 9:25, you have the other bell. So we are all synchronized with the common bell. So here in our synchronous sequential circuit also, you have a common bell, which is called your clock. And you must have heard about this when you purchase your laptops. Okay, you might have you might have seen megahertz. So laptop with some 148 megahertz. Okay, so that is nothing but the speed of your clock. So your components in your laptop, that is your digital components in the laptop, are all synchronized to a common clock. So there is a continuous pulse that is being generated in your laptop or in all digital devices, and all different components are synchronized to that digital clock. So if it is synchronized and if it depends, so even if the input change, the main difference is, even if there is a change in the input, your output will not change unless you apply the clock. That is the main difference. Okay. So unless the bell rings, none of us will be ready for the next session. That is the concept. Even if the faculty is ready or if the student is ready with their material or any whatever it is, only when the bell rings, there will be a change. That is the concept behind synchronous sequential circuit. But that concept is not there in your asynchronous sequential circuit. You just have a feedback path. So to change the input, you have some output, and there will be an output coming from this feedback path, and it will take some few amounts of time to propagate along this feedback path and enter into the circuit. And again, there will be a change because now there is a new input coming. There won't be any change in the external input, but there will be a change in this feedback input. Just because you have a change here, there will be some evaluation that happens in the combinational logic, and there might be change in your output, or there might be a change in the value, and it will keep on circulating until your stabilizes. So we'll see more about it later. We need not get too much about it now. So know that First, we will be designing combinational logic, which will be very simple. So your output depends only on the input. But in a sequential circuit, your output will depend on the external input as well as your current state. Either it will be from the memory element or will be dependent on your feedback path. Clear? So designing such circuits will be a little more complex than designing your combinational circuit. So first we'll see combinational, designing combinational circuits. So this is what is represented in a tabular form. Okay, whatever we have seen is represented in a tabular form. Okay, so two things we'll be discussing, analysis and design. The difference between analysis and design is, so you are already having, suppose you already have a digital circuit, and if you want to study what that circuit is doing, then we'll do an analysis. You do not know what exactly is there. You have a circuit diagram, but you want to know the functionality of the circuit diagram, then you will do an analysis. Okay, suppose you have a function with you. I want to subtract two numbers, two 64-bit numbers. That is the function I have. Now I want a circuit for it. So what I need to do? I need to do a design. Okay. So suppose I have a problem at hand, and if I want to find out the digital circuit for it, then we'll go for the design problem. Suppose I have a circuit with me, and if I want to know what is the functionality of the circuit, I'll do an analysis. Clear? So first we'll quickly go through the analysis and then go for the design problems. So from the given circuit, so what will be given? This circuit will be given to you. You are given with a circuit. You need to find out what it does. So first step is you need to find out the Boolean function. How will we draw the circuit diagram? Only with a Boolean expression or a function you will draw. So you have to identify the Boolean function. Once you have the Boolean function, you should represent the Boolean function in the form of a truth table. So to convert the Boolean function into a truth table, you should identify the input variables and the number of output functions in the Boolean function or in the circuit diagram, and fill the truth table with the n inputs, 2 power n rows, and then evaluate the Boolean function. You will have a truth table, complete truth table. Because our Boolean functions will contain AND, OR, and NOT, the basic gates, basic operations. Okay. And if it is very large, if it is having a large input, then it is not manually possible for us. Suppose it is 3, 4, or maximum 5, 2 power 5 combinations, then we will be able to manually work out. But if you have many inputs, then it is not manually possible for us to work out. But there are tools for doing a simulation. Okay. We'll see at the end. So first we'll follow few steps and apply it in an example problem. So you are given a circuit now. First confirm that it is a combinational circuit. So you have to check whether it is a combinational circuit. How will you check this? It is a combinational circuit? Yes, can you give me in the chat? How will you identify that it is a combinational circuit and not a sequential circuit? What is the major thing by which you will ensure if that it is not a sequential circuit? Yes, given the chat box, ma, how will you ensure that it is not sequential without memory? Only memory, without memory, okay. Without, very good. Gajashriya without feedback. So check for a feedback line, because by looking at the circuit, what is a feedback line? The output of the circuit will be connected to the input of a gate. So check if there is no feedback, and if there is a feedback, then it will become a sequential. If there is no feedback, then it becomes a combinational. Okay, so first ensure that it is a combinational. Then the rest of the steps are simple. Just you have to label the inputs and outputs of all the gates in the given problem and write the Boolean expression. Step by step you write. So first write for the first level where the gates are directly connected to the external input. So for the first level of the gates, you will have to write the output and the Boolean function. Then from the first level, go to step 3, which will be the next level of gates. So output of one gate will be connected to the input of another gate. So then label the outputs of those gates using the previously labeled gates, and repeatedly do the process, step 3 process, until all the outputs are labeled, and finally you reach the output of the circuit. Okay, the simple circuit will contain only level 1 and level 2, but a complex circuit can contain many levels. So you have to go repeat the step 3 until you reach the final output, external output. Then after that, then you can find out the, substitute the expressions one within the other from the previous level and get a fully expanded Boolean function. Okay, so once you get the Boolean function, then you can okay, then the next step will be to fill the truth table. So first we'll do the analysis with an example. We'll apply the procedure. Okay, this is the given problem. So in the given problem, you have the inputs as well as the outputs that you need to identify. So these are all the external inputs to the circuits, and these two are outputs from the circuit. Okay, so it is not neither too complex, not very simple. So if it is a simple circuit, you can imagine only this part, only two levels. Now a little more we have. Okay, given. So what we need to do, first step, you need to identify or label the gates which are connected to the external inputs. So these are the external inputs. Now one by one you can give names for the outputs of the gates. So this randomly you can give, there is no procedure. Our aim is to get the final Boolean expression. So naming order of naming is not important here. Okay, so T1, all the outputs of the gates are numbered for F1 now. Then for F2 also you have to do a numbering. So here you can see this is just AB, simple expressions. This is AC. They have not given specific names. Then this is just an SOP expression. The output of this gate will be AB plus AC plus BC. Okay, that is directly given to F2. Now you can give, write the expression for T2. So what will be T2? It is ABC. What is T1? It is A plus B plus C. Hope you are able to differentiate between an AND gate and OR gate. So this is your AND gate and this is your OR gate. Okay, and this is your NOT gate. This is AND and this is OR. So T1 A plus B plus C, T2 is ABC. So what is T3? T3 is nothing but T1 dot F2 complement. Okay. Then what is F1? It is T3 plus T2. So you are writing it in terms of the temporary variables, intermediate variables. Then later on you have to apply what is T3, what is T2 and expand the expression. So what is F1? F1 is equal to T3 plus T2. So here we are able to expand what is T3 and T2. T3 we already know it is F2 complement T1. And what is T2? T2 is ABC. Okay, you have just substituted. Then what is F2 complement? The whole thing complement. So you apply the De Morgan's law. And then T1 is here. So substitute and you will get this expression. Then apply the De Morgan's law, expand, then A plus B, then ABC. Then you can again apply the distributive law, expand, and then finally you get this expression. Okay, you can work out and see whether you get this expression. So F1 is equal to this expression and F2 is this. Clear? So what is that we are doing? We are given a circuit diagram. You have to identify the external inputs, external outputs, then label the outputs of the gates, and then find out the expression, Boolean expression, by applying the simple gates AND, OR and NOT. And then finally, level by level, you apply and get the, check the input for each and every gate and you will be able to get the expression for all the gates. Then apply repeatedly and get the Boolean function in terms of the input variables A, B and C. Clear? Okay. Now, once you get the expression, now you have to fill your truth table. So, as I already told you, in the previous problem, we have three variables. A, B and C are the three variables. So, how many rows you will have? 2 power 3, which is equal to 8. Okay. So, 8 rows we will have. And how many outputs you have? F1 and F2. So, 2 output columns. So, 3 input columns and 2 output columns. So, altogether 5 columns you will have and 8 rows you will have. So, that is what is specified. Okay. So, this is the evaluated table. So, I have given the Boolean expression which was derived in the previous table. So, F2 and F1 are the output functions you need. But it is all these functions are very elaborate functions. So you cannot evaluate it in a single step. So these intermediate outputs you can have. Then finally you can rewrite your table, truth table, by having only 5 columns. Okay, this is optional. Since we are doing it manually, it will be difficult for us to evaluate the expression, a big expression. So we will have some intermediate values so that you can use it to evaluate the function. So for example, what is F2? F2 is AB plus AC plus BC. So you can use the input. So this part will be empty. The output part will be empty. You can do an evaluation. A dot B, 0. Then A dot C, again it will be 0. Then B dot C, 0 dot 0 will be equal to 0. So 0 plus 0 plus 0 will be equal to 0. Okay. Same way we'll try evaluating the other one. A, B. So A, B, the part is 0. A and C, 0 dot 1. Again it is 0. Then B and C, again it is 0. So again, still it is equal to 0. Now we will see one more example. We'll take this row. AB, it is 0. Then plus A into C, A dot C, 0 dot 1 will be equal to 0. Then you have BC. BC, 1 dot 1. 1 dot 1 is equal to 1. So 0 or 0 or 1. All these are by your logical gate operations AND and OR. Okay, don't get confused with binary arithmetic. It is AND and OR. 0 or 1 is equal to 1. That is why we have a 1 over here. Okay, so you can take this example. Do you evaluate the expression and see. Similarly for F1. So if you take F1, the expression itself was very complex. Okay, so X. Here you can see the expression itself is very complex, but it can be evaluated using the previously evaluated expression. It depends on T3 plus T2. And what is T3 plus T2? You can have F2 complement plus T1, F2 complement T1 plus ABC. Okay, that is your T2. So you can do step-by-step evaluation before you do the final evaluation. That is why we have taken some intermediate steps. Okay. So intermediate steps are evaluated before we evaluate F1. So once you get the truth table, then that is your functionality. So your function can be represented in the form of a truth table. If you want to do still analyze further, you can find out whether this truth table, from this truth table, you can find out whether it is doing addition operation or subtraction operation, or it is finding a complementary operation, or it is finding some other function. So you can do an analysis on the input and output alone and find out, you can map input and output and find out what exactly the function is. Clear? So this is an analysis. So analysis is, given your circuit diagram, you need to find out the Boolean expression, and using the Boolean expression, you have to fill your truth table. Okay, but we will focus mainly on design. You need just know what is an analysis, but we will do main focus on design. And design is nothing but the reverse of your analysis. Okay, so we'll do more problems in design. Hope analysis is clear. Any doubt in the analysis part of combinational circuits? Yes, can I have yes, no in the chat box? Yes, any doubt in analysis part? A little bit vague? Yes, yes, no, what does it mean? Are you clear? Clear, okay, ma. So might be if you, when you do design, then analysis will be more clear, because it's just the reverse of your design process. And again, I want to remind you, at the end of the session, a link will be given for your online quiz. So don't leave the session. Okay, it will be given only in the chat box, which will cover unit 1. Okay. So our main focus will be on design. The rest of all the units will be designing your combinational circuit, design synchronous sequential circuits, design asynchronous sequential circuits, design memory, design error correction codes, error recovery codes, all are designed. Completely we will be designed. So our what is the name of the subject? Digital principles and system design. So we, our main focus will be to design circuits. So why do we want to design, and what is the main objective? Our objective is of design will be to reduce the cost. So if you want to reduce the cost, then you have to reduce the number of gates, and then IC packages. IC packages is integrated chips. You must have used in your physics practical sessions, where each and every IC comes with a fixed number of gates. So if you reduce the number of gates, each in turn will reduce the number of ICs required in the circuit. Okay. And we need to increase the speed. So if you have a complex circuit, then Nowadays, you can see how quick our we are just learning circuits where you can add, subtract, and so on. But you have complex circuits within our mobile device or your laptop or any digital gadget. And you can see we are not at all patient enough to wait for more than a second. Immediately when we press an enter, it has to give us our output. That means we are working towards speed. And the other is modularity. So modularity is you need to have reusable components. So once I design a circuit for addition, it should be capable. I can use that IC for addition in various other devices. Okay, so it should be a reusable simple circuit. That means I should have a well-defined input and output. Okay, that is a reusable block. So in programming also you use the same concept. So you will have a well-defined input and output, that is the interface. So that is how we need to design. So practically we'll minimize the number of gates, minimize the number of inputs to gates and lot of interconnections. It will be very tedious for us to design even manually, so we will have to avoid it. And to increase the speed, the propagation time of the signal in the circuit should be very minimal. Propagation time. What is the propagation time? From one component to another, the signal to travel from one component to another. So might be from one gate to another, or from one digital combinational circuit to another digital combinational circuit. It might be from one adder to another adder, one adder to multiplexer. So each one is a component, digital component. Okay. So the propagation time through the circuit should be very minimal, so that the output, final output, we'll get it quickly. Okay, these are few aspects we need to consider when we are designing. Okay, first we'll see the procedure for designing. So as I told, it is just the reverse of our analysis. So I have a problem at hand. Now I need to have a circuit. So what will be given? The problem will be a verbal description, an English-like statement. Okay, I have an input in X, Y, Z as the input. I have the A and B are the outputs. And if this input is given, I will, if these are the inputs, this will be my output. Some description, some verbal description. That is what will be given to me. Now, from the given statement, I need to identify the inputs. What are the inputs? How many inputs are there? And how many outputs are there? And what are the outputs? And label them clearly. So once I identify the inputs and outputs, then we have to represent it in the form of a truth table. And I need some domain knowledge so that I can fill my truth table. Okay. So if this is the input, this is the output. So I need some knowledge on the functionality of the circuit. So if I have to design a circuit for 2's complement, so manually I should be able to calculate for every input combination what is the 2's complement output. So complete calculation should be done and fill the truth table. Once you fill the truth table, then from the truth table using the K-map, then you can derive the Boolean function. And one thing is, if you have one output function, for every output function, you will have one K-map that has to be used. Okay. So if you have 3 output functions, then you have to use 3 K-maps separately and write the Boolean expression separately, simplified Boolean expression. Once you get the simplified Boolean expression, then you can draw the circuit diagram. Hope you are clear with the steps. So given the problem, identify the inputs and outputs, label them correctly, then draw your truth table, and you have to manually evaluate each and every input and output. So you have to map the outputs to the corresponding inputs. So do a calculation and fill the output columns. Input column you can easily fill. How will you fill input column? If it is a 3 variable, it will be 2 power 3, that is 8. That means all 8 combinations, 0, 0, 0 to 1, 1, 1. And if it is a 4 variable, then all 4 zeros to 4, 1 combination, that you can fill. But the output you have to evaluate and fill the outputs. Then once you evaluate the output, the next step is K-map. K-map, you are already familiar. So K-map, use the K-map, derive the Boolean expression, and then draw the circuit. Very important procedure. Sometimes they even ask this four step, explain the design procedure. You can take your own example and design. Okay, now we will see how to design some arbitrary combinational circuits. So later on we will see how to design an adder, subtractor. Now it's just an arbitrary circuit. We'll just give an verbal explanation. Okay, so for this is your first example. Design a combinational circuit with 3 inputs and 1 output. Here they have explicitly specified the number of inputs and number of output. The output is 1 when the binary value of the input is less than or equal to 3. The output is 0 otherwise. Clear? So this is the given problem. Simple problem, very simple problem. So the circuit identifies whether the given input is less than or equal to 3 or greater than 3. So four inputs, 0, 1, 2 and 3, the output will be equal to 1. And it is specified that we have 3 inputs. 3 inputs means how many combinations? 8 combinations. So if the input is 4, 5, 6 and 7, the output will be equal to 0. Clear? Clear with the problem? Very simple arbitrary function I have taken. Okay? So remember this. So 0, 1, 2 and 3, it should be equal to 1. 4, 5, 6, 7, the output should be equal to 0. Now we will have formed the truth table. So the truth table contains 3 inputs and 1 output. So if since it is a 3 input truth table, fill all combinations of one cell is missing for me. Okay, I have missed one cell. All one combination. Okay. All one combination, we'll see. So 0, 0, 0, it is, as told, it is 0, then 1, then 2, then 3, then 4, 5, 6, and you should have one more cell, row 7, which is all ones. Okay. So what is the problem? The output of 1, output is 1 when the binary value of the input is less than or equal to 3. So till this, it will be equal to 1 and the rest of it will be equal to 0. Clear? So from this we will see. So last row is also all ones will have a 0 output. So now you have to, what is the next step after filling the truth table? So from the problem description, you filled the truth table. Now from the truth table, you have to plot your K-map. So it's a 3 input variable problem. So you have to use a 3 variable K-map. So depending on the number of inputs to the problem, you have to use the K-map. Clear? You need not worry about the number of outputs. It depends only on the number of inputs. So you have to plot the k map. So 0, 1, 2 and 3 you have, and you can group all the four ones and you can write the expression. And this is a very simple expression. So it is x complement. F is equal to x complement. So derive the Boolean expression, then draw the circuit. So input is x, output is f. Clear? It's a very, very simple problem. Okay, we'll take another example, a little more complex than the previous example. Is any doubt in example one? Yes, are you clear with the procedure for example one? Yes? Please reply in the chat box, ma'am. Yes, Shivani, Nityashree. Okay, so first example, you are clear. So now we will move on to the second example. So design a combinational circuit with four inputs and one output. Yes, very good. So four inputs and one output. The output is one if the input variables have more ones than zeros. So you have to count the number of ones in the input combination. If you have more number of ones in the input, then the output will be equal to 1. Otherwise, the output is 0. And how many inputs you have? You have 4 inputs. So what is the first step? You have to fill your truth table from the given description. So it is a 4 variable problem. So all 4 combination, all 16 combination, all 4 zeros to all 4 ones. Okay, so all combinations you have to fill. So this is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, this is 5, 8, then 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14 and 15, 0 to 15. Now you need to fill the output. What does the problem say? If you have more number of ones than zeros, then you will have an output of 1. So count the number of ones. So if you have more than more number of ones means if you have 3 or 4 ones. So you check where you have 3 or 4 ones. So here you have 3 ones. Then here you have 3 ones. Here you have 3 ones. Then here you have 3 ones. And here you have 4 ones. So these locations where you have 3 or 4 ones will have a 1, and the rest of the locations outputs will have 0. Are you clear? So the problem states that if you have more number of ones in the input combination than zeros, then your output will be equal to 1. So here you can see, if you have 2 ones means equal, it becomes equal. So 3 ones or 4 ones in an input combination, then it will be equal to 1. Hope you are clear on how to fill your truth table. So it depends on the problem. So understand the problem and fill your truth table. Are you clear? Any doubt so far? Okay. Now, so this is your filled truth table now. Now, once the truth table is ready, we will go for K-map. So it's a 4 variable K-map because you have 4 input variables A, B, C, and D. So first step, you draw the 4 variable K-map, label them and number them, and then you have to start filling your K-map. So already here you have got the ones. So don't worry about the locations where you have got zeros. So this is 7. This is 11, 13, 14 and 15. So these are the locations where you have ones. So now we will fill our K map. So 7. How did I identify 7? The input combination is 0, 1, 1, 1. So sometimes this will not work. So check for the input combination 0, 1, 1, 1. So 0, 1 here, 1, 1 here. That value, that cell has 7. 1. That is 7 and it is 1. Clear? So from the truth table, you have to plot your K map. Next, we'll see. It is 1011. So it is 10 here, 11 is here. So the corresponding cell is 1. Clear? Then the next one is 13. So 1101. So 11 is here. And 01, which is this column, so we have plotted a 1. Similarly, 1110, 1110, here you will plot a 1, and all 1s, here you will plot a 1. Clear? So, clear with plotting? So, you have to carefully plot, because labeling, plotting, if you make a mistake, then everything. If you make a mistake in the truth table, again, there is no other, no one will be able to help you, because your Boolean function, truth table, your K-map, everything will go wrong. Now, once you have plotted the K-map, then your regular grouping. So you can group 7 and 15 and write the product term for that, okay, as before. Then you can group 13 and 15 and write a product term for that. Then 14 and 15, write the product term for it. Then 11 and 15, you group and write the product term. And this is your expression. So F is equal to BCD plus ABD plus ABC plus ACD. Clear? So first step, identify the inputs and outputs and fill your truth table, which is your second step. Then use your K-map and derive the Boolean expression. What is the next step? Yes, what is the next step? Yes, in your chat box, can you remember what is the next step for design? What is the next step for the design? Okay, you have identified the Boolean expression. The next step is logic diagram. Very good. You have to draw the logic diagram. Again, logic diagram, drawing a logic diagram will be very simple if you understand the base. Okay, you need not by heart anything. Only few circuits you need to practice. That will also automatically come when you repeatedly practice. So here, I'll give you a simplest way of drawing your Boolean circuit, your logic diagram. So this is the expression. So how many variables you have? You have 4 variables. So whenever you have 4 or 3 variables, now the base of your diagram, you have to draw like this. So A, A complement, B, B complement, C, C complement, D and D complement. So one line for the variable as such, and another line through the NOT gate. So this is your NOT gate, and draw another line. Clear? So you have A, A complement, B, B complement, C, C complement, D, D complement. In this problem, you don't have any complement, but I wanted you to follow a standard procedure so that it is easier for you. So once you are having this, then we can start representing each of the term. So BCD, what is BCD? B dot C dot D, and the gate that we'll be using for this term is your AND gate. So first, draw your AND gate. Okay. This is your AND gate. Now, after drawing the AND gate, just connect B, line B, line C and line D. So carefully start from line B and put a line. This is B. Then carefully start from C and put a line. Then carefully start from D and put a line. So output for this will be equal to B, C, D. Any doubt in drawing this? Yes, please reply. After drawing the entire expression, it will be so chaotic. And then if you try to draw, look at the diagram and draw, it will become a hibiscus diagram just like your biology class, not a digital class. Clear? Yes, please reply, ma'am. Are you clear in drawing the circuit diagram? So the same thing we will be using. Yes, Vemula, fine. Yes, others, please respond, because later on your circuits will become very complex. We won't have very good, very good. Saujanya, Ramya, Shreya, Sivaranjani. Okay. So now can you easily draw ABD? The next term is ABD. So again, another AND gate. So start from A and connect it to this. Then B, start from the line B and connect it to the input. Then D, start from D and connect to the input. So your next term will be A, B, D. Clear? Same way we will draw the third term, A, B, C. So from A, connect a line to the input, then from B, connect a line to the input, then from C, connect a line to the input. So your third term will be A, B, C. Then the last term is A, C, D. So A, okay, draw the gate first. A, then C, then from D, which will be equal to A, C and D. So now all the product terms are available. Now what is the next operation? It's your sum operation. So the sum operation, you can directly give it to your OR gate. So connect, bring all the outputs of an AND gate to one location and connect everything to a single gate, which is your OR gate. So this is your function F. Are you clear? So this is one standard way of drawing, which will be, you can follow for all circuits from first unit to the end. And it is not that it should be always like this. You can have it just like we had an analysis problem also you can have. But if you have this, it will be easier for us to draw. Okay. So all inputs you put the variable as well as the complement as an input. Then depending on the term you can have. Is clear so far? So clear on the complete diagram, logic design diagram? Yes, reply in the chat box, ma. If you are clear, we can proceed to the next one. Yes, are you clear? Quick. Okay. If you have doubts, you please stop me now and then and then clarify your doubts. Okay. So one more simple example. So once you are clear with this design procedure, all circuit designs will be of the same format. So one example for code conversion we'll quickly see, and then I'll give you the link for your quiz. So BCD to XS3. So just I'll give you an overview. So BCD in input is BCD and XS3 is your output. Okay. So what is BCD? Binary coded decimal. And here I have taken only 4-bit BCD and BCD numbers, it is valid from 0 to 9. Beyond this, it is not valid. Okay, so we'll see how it is being done. So you have to fill the XS3, corresponding XS3. So how do you fill XS3? It is plus 3. So 0 plus 3, you will add 3 to it. So you will add 3 to it and you will get. So this is 3. Then sequentially you can go. So 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 and 12. Here till this, you have the table filled. And I told you from 10 to 15, it is invalid. So all these are taken as don't cares. Okay. So all are taken as don't cares. BCD to XS3. These input combinations, we are not worried about it. So these invalid input combinations, we are taking it as don't cares. So how many output columns you have? 4 output columns. And input columns, you have 4. So what came up you will use? How many variable came up will you use? Is for this problem, how many variable came up will you use? Yes, chat box. I'm waiting for chat box. It's a 3 variable came up, or 4 variable, or 5 variable, or 6 variable, or 7 variable. What came up will you use for this BCD to XS3 conversion? It's quick. Yes, what came up will you use? How many variable came up? I'm just asking how many variable came up. The came up variable, the size of the came up depends on. Yes, 4 variable came up. Very good. The size of the came up depends on the input. Okay, number of inputs. Very good, very good, very good. I was waiting for this. Very good. Now, 4 variables. So here we have a 4 input column. So the k-map size which you have to use is a 4 variable k-map. Now, how many output columns I have? I have 4 output columns. So I have to use 4 such k-maps. 1 k-map for E0, 1 for E1, E2, E3, separately, and derive 4 separate Boolean expressions. Clear? So you can, I think you can try this in your, well, so 4 variable k-map, all labeling done. Now you can plot them. So you have to do a plotting of this column E0. So check the label and correspondingly do the plot. So 0, 0, 0, it is plotted. Then 0, 0, 1, 0. 0, 0, 1, 0, it is plotted. Likewise, 0, 1, 0, 0. 0, 1, 0, 0. You will have a 1 over here. Then 0, 1, 1, 0. 0, 1, 1, 0. Here you will have a 1. Then you have an 1 over here. 1, 0, 0, 0. 1, 0 is here. 0, 0. Here you will have a 1. Then the rest of it is all don't cast. Don't forget to plot your don't cast. You will have a very complex expression. So you have to do the plotting for don't cast. So 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14 and 15. All these are don't cast. Okay. After plotting all the don't cast, now you have to do a grouping. So you have a wraparound grouping. Do a grouping and write the Boolean expression. So the expression for E0 will be equal to D complement. So I think we will proceed the rest in the next session. I want you to spend time solving. Yes, we'll continue in the next session, just to give a flavor of your code conversion I started. So hope you are all clear with the design problem. Okay, so the general procedure for design, we'll continue in the next session. I will give you the link. In the chat box. So this is the link for your online quiz, which will contain 20 questions. And all of you should have should log in through your college mail ID so that you can take the quiz. Yes, are you able to open my first 15 questions? Will be just MCQs. So all are MCQs, but first 15 are you can directly click. The rest of it are KMAP.